Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance for one of their celebrity lectures. Let's go see what Cindy has for us today.
Welcome everyone to the Western Museum of Flight. I'm Cindy Maka, the director. Launching from deep security in the middle of the North American continent to the skies above some of the most hazardous places on Earth, these intrepid pilots travel to the very edge of space to provide vital intelligence to our military and political decision makers. Working in real time at unimaginable velocities, a very special, uniquely qualified lone warrior pilots his unarmed, intensely fast aircraft into and through the target area to bring his vital information to the decision makers who will apply it for immediate result. In this rarefied atmosphere, in their own special world, these elite silent warriors fly their trade. So today we are going to hear things that most other human beings have never been allowed to know. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome one of those elite silent warriors, Maury Rosenberg.
Thank you, Cindy. Thank all of you for showing up for this presentation. I appreciate it. I hope it's informative and entertaining for you. Just a brief overview, we're going to show a video that's about 6 minutes long, approximately. And it was made and dedicated to Kelly Johnson upon his retirement. Then I'm going to go through a PowerPoint presentation that is directed mainly to my experience with the SR-71 and the time frames that I flew the SR-71. I flew it in two different time frames, from 1973 to 1978, and from December in 1980 through August in 1984. I'd also like to introduce one of the RSO's reconnaissance systems officer that I flew with, who was gracious enough to come in from Lancaster to visit for this presentation and was instrumental in helping me make this PowerPoint. Ed McKim is in the back, standing up, waving at everybody. And Ed's with his wife, Michelle. And Ed and I were flying together in August of 1981 when the North Koreans fired a SA-2 SAM missile at us. And that'll be in part of the presentation. Okay, yeah, this is Ed McKim. He's also a retired lieutenant colonel from the Air Force and also retired from Northrop Grumman. And he helped me put this PowerPoint presentation together and did most of the work, actually. He's a new retiree. I've laid back since I've been retired so long.
Yeah, I do need it. I just got a haircut, too.
Oh, wow. So we'll get underway, Betty, okay? Thank you. And now I'm going to show the video, which was dedicated to Kelly Johnson in 1990 for his retirement from Lockheed and the Skunk Works. Okay, we'll start on in. As I mentioned, retired United States Air Force Lieutenant Colonel. I had 38 plus years in an aviation career, which included United Airlines. I flew the F-4 Phantom. I flew the C and D and E model. I flew the F-4C when I was in Vietnam. I was also stationed in Japan flying the F-4C, and I flew the F-4C at Nellis Air Force Base as an instructor in the Fighter Weapons School. I had 1,090 hours in the SR-71, and they were all operational hours. As a point of interest, there were only approximately 85 to 95 pilots that flew the SR-71 during its history that flew operational sorties. There were other pilots that flew test in the very beginning on the A-12 and then on the SR-71. And then there was also a cadre of pilots that flew flight test down at Palmdale. There were approximately, I believe, about 150 RSOs, or radar system officers, reconnaissance systems officers, excuse me, Ed being one of those. I had 212 combat sorties in the F-4C in Vietnam. Here's some interesting facts. There's a sheet that has a lot of fun facts about the SR-71. Its designed limit was 3.3 Mach, which is approximately 2,200 miles per hour, 36 miles a minute. In reality, the pilot's handbook says that the limiting speed factor was the compressor inlet temperature, or a CIT gauge, compressor inlet temperature. And we were limited to 427 degrees centigrade at the face of the compressor. And depending on outside air temperature, the aircraft would go faster than 3.3. I think I've seen about 3.35. I know a few people that said they got up to 3.4. Normally, we cruised at Mach 3.0. They actually had our missions designed where we had some missions at Mach 2.8, but most of them were at Mach 3.0, 3.1, and 3.2. And we always flew an afterburner. Once we lit the afterburners to start a climb to go supersonic to altitude, we would stay in afterburner. And if we were flying at 3.0 Mach, we would be in minimum afterburner, mid afterburner for 3.1, and 3.2 would be max afterburner. We would travel approximately 2,000 miles before we'd be looking for a tanker to come down to refuel. The structure of the SR-71 is 93% titanium, and the CIA actually purchased the titanium from the Russians, who we were planning to spy on. And as the video mentioned, Kelly Johnson was playing with stealth when he designed the SR-71. The leading edge that goes around the entire airplane and the wing foil, the fuselage is sculptured and called a chine effect, similar to a boat. And the first 6 to 8 inches is honeycombed, and it's composite material, which absorbs and does not reflect radar returns. One of the reasons the rudders are slanted in, because it's an oblique angle and it doesn't reflect as much radar return as if it was a 90 degree angle. As everyone knows, I think it was designed and built by Lockheed Skunk Works. I met Kelly Johnson several times when I was at Beale, when I first got there in 1973. And he was a real people person. He liked to talk to the mechanics and the pilots and the navigators. He really liked personal feedback from the people that maintained and operated the aircraft. And I remember one person asking one time, why is it black? And he had explained basically what this slide says, in the fact that although black absorbs heat, once you heat an object up to its max temperature, black radiates heat faster than any other color. So it would maintain a constant heat, approximately. And also because it's black, obviously nicknamed the Blackbird, as the U-2 was called the Dragon Lady, although it's black also, and some people sometimes refer to both aircraft as the Blackbirds. It's a single pilot, two-man crew. The RSO in the back seat had no flight controls. He operated all the sensors, which included the radar, film-type cameras, which would be similar to your digital cameras, but at that time they had what was called an optical bar camera, which is more like a 35-millimeter camera. We're talking some old technology, but the enhancements and the product that it produced were unbelievably accurate. They could distinguish from 80,000 feet in approximately 150,000 foot slant range, you could distinguish two objects that were at least 6 inches apart. So anyhow, the RSO operated all those systems, plus the navigation. It had an astro inertial navigation system, which was a star tracker. And just behind the rear cockpit, there's a glass window that houses the ANS, Astro Inertial Navigation System. And we would feed a tape into it. It was an old card punch to make a tape. And they would feed it in, and it would tell the navigation system what part of the world it was going to be in, what the Julian date and the time and so forth were. And it knew it had over 200 star catalogs that it could look at. So it could track stars for that area that you were in. And when it was tracking stars, I think, what was the accuracy, Ed? Do you remember?
1,000 feet,
500 feet of center line? The pressure suits, we wore a full pressure suit, much like the astronauts. It was required because of the altitude we were at if we lost cabin pressurization. And also the pressure suit was our capsule. If we had to eject out of the aircraft at speed and altitude, the suit would inflate to protect our body. It also had in the seat pack, and the seat you were sitting on would come out with you. And it had oxygen, enough oxygen to last for 15 minutes. And we would free fall from whatever altitude we ejected to about 15,000 feet. And I believe we were told that from 80,000 feet to free fall in the seat, it had a drogue chute that came out so it wouldn't spin or tumble. It took approximately 10 to 12 minutes. An interesting note, during the early test, there was a test pilot that ejected, and because of the difference in temperature between his body temperature on the inside of his face mask and the outside air temperature, the face mask froze over. He couldn't see out. He knew he was falling. He said it was the longest 10 minutes of his life. And at 15,000 feet, you get snapped out of the seat and your main parachute deploys. He opened his faceplate at that time. Because of that incident in the test phase, they modified the pilot's faceplates. They were made out of glass, and they wove a fine gold strand through them and hooked up a heating element so that it would be heated so it wouldn't frost over if you had to bail out. The RSOs had a plastic faceplate. The cost, I believe, for the glass ones was in the neighborhood of about $3,500, $4,000 each one, so it was expensive. I also note in here that it's derived from the Gemini space program, and if you Google Young and Crippen, on the Google page, you'll see a picture of them sitting in the shuttle, each looking over their shoulder back at the camera, and the seat and the suit they are in, the seat is actually an SR-71 seat. The first shuttle flights used an SR-71 ejection seat, and the pressure suit they're wearing is the same one that the SR-71 used. The faceplate had a sunshade like sunglasses, and that's why it's dark that you see here. You could put that up or take it down, obviously. Mach 3 cruise talks about the temperature and that the aircraft would heat up to over 600 degrees Fahrenheit in certain places. Anyone that's ever been up to SR-71 in close proximity will notice in the wing route where the wing comes into the fuselage, there's a gap about like this. They don't meet. I don't mean that you can see through it, but the outer skin has a gap. And the engineer said that came together as the aircraft heated up, so it would actually grow in size. The windows on the SR-71, the side windows, would get so hot that even with your pressure suit and those gloves that were fire retardant, you couldn't hold your hand against the side window for more than about 30 seconds. It would be too hot to touch if you held it there. The U-2 aircraft, not traveling at the speeds we did not heat up like that. Even though both the U-2 and the SR-71 are at high altitudes, it's more rarefied air. The molecules are further apart in the air or the atmosphere. But because of the speed the SR was traveling, the friction is what would actually heat the aircraft up. The front cockpit had a periscope. When you close the canopy down, there's a little periscope you could push up, primarily used to look behind you and trim the rudders, the twin rudders that were canted in. As long as everything's trimmed and smooth, the aircraft doesn't have any parasitic drag. Or like something hanging out the window. Put your hand out the window of your car when you're doing 60 miles an hour and turn it this way or this way, and you feel quite a difference. Most takeoffs were at about half a fuel load, which was 40,000 pounds. The aircraft could hold up to 80,000 pounds. And the basic weight, depending on what kind of sensors the aircraft was carrying, was in the neighborhood of 50 to 60,000 pounds. So you're talking about close to 100,000 pound takeoff weight with 40,000 pounds of fuel. And the engines each developed 35,000 pounds of thrust, so you had almost a 3/4 to 1 thrust-to-weight ratio. The ignition for the engine, it says it's a pyrophoric. It means it ignites when it comes in contact with the atmosphere or air. It was called TEB, which was short for triethyl boron. The TEB was put into a tank that had to be inerted with nitrogen gas because it's very explosive and highly dangerous. There were some sorties that were flown that went operational, or what you want to call hot. When we went above Mach 2.8, it was considered hot time. Anything over Mach 3.0 is hot time with regard to the maintenance. But we had some sorties. I can recall one out of Okinawa, Japan, where we put on about an extra 25,000 pounds. So we were up to about a 65,000 pound fuel load, and we'd do a hot sortie first, and then refuel down or descend down and refuel. And guys used to see how fast they could get up to altitude, which was approximately 77, 78,000 feet. On brake release and rotation, you would ease the nose of the plane over after you put the gear up, and you'd be doing about 500 knots at the end of the runway, and you'd just start a climb until you started going supersonic. The best time I've ever heard of was less than 14 minutes from brake release to 77,000 feet in Mach 3.0. pictures depicting the cockpit, you can see they were pretty busy cockpits. It's not like what you might see in magazines now with regard to video screens or LCD displays and so forth. The cockpit itself, even though you had the pressure suit on, it's probably one of the biggest cockpits I ever flew with regard to Air Force airplanes. Along the sides on the pilot side, it doesn't depict back past the throttles on the left side, you can see, but it's the same on both sides. There were rows and rows and rows of circuit breaker panels. And whenever you had a problem, one of the first things in your checklist was to check circuit breakers. You could just reach up and run your hand along the rows, and you could tell if one had popped and see what it is and push it in. So this was the time frame I flew the SR-71. I joined the Air Force. I went to officer training school in 1965, January of 65, and pilot training in April of 65. I got into the SR-71 in April of 73 and flew it till the end of June of 78. And these are the primary missions we did at that time. We did the photo reconnaissance, radar, and electronic gathering of information. We flew primarily out of Okinawa, Japan. We also flew operational sorties out of Beale Air Force Base over Cuba. The initial Cuba sorties, we briefed at midnight and took off, I think, at 1 or 2 in the morning. And it was for the sun angles when we were going to fly over Cuba. And a side note here, at our briefings, we had two gentlemen in black suits, and they would brief us on recovery if we had to eject, and they would give us a classified packet to carry. And inside the packet was a chip, if you want to call it, that you had to snap open, and it had numbers and letters on it. And they said, if you have to eject and you land in Cuba and you turn on your radio, somebody's going to ask you for those letters and numbers, and that's what's going to be your rescue. We also flew in 1973 in the Egyptian-Israeli war, or skirmish, whatever you want to call it, seven sorties, starting in September of 1973. I think the last sortie was around January of 74. It was about a 15,000-mile round trip. It was a 9-hour sortie, and the sortie had an airborne spare. The first airplane took off at approximately midnight, and the spare took off at 1 in the morning. When the spare was about a little over an hour into the flight, they would get a call from the primary airplane that he'd crossed a certain line, and that was a point where if he had a problem, the spare couldn't continue because of the sun angles wouldn't be good. I know that sounds crazy because he's an hour behind him to begin with, but till he got there, they were worried about jeopardizing the take, and it was just sort of a go-no-go point for the spare, even though he had no problems. Every one of those missions, we were told, I don't know how true it is, we were told they were reviewed and executed by Henry Kissinger. So there's a lot of high exposure in this program. I got out of the Air Force in 78 and ended up being hired by United Airlines. I flew with them for just about 2 years until I was furloughed and went back on active duty. And because of my unique background, the Air Force sent me back to the SR-71. Hooray! So we had expanded operations in that 2 years that I was out, and that's when Ed and I got crewed together in 1981. We were still overflying Southeast Asia in 81. We were still going down to North and South Vietnam and Cambodia and Laos. We overflew Korea. We did Europe, where we would go in out of Mildenhall, RAF Mildenhall in England. We had a permanent detachment there. We'd fly through the Baltic and look at Poland and Lithuania and Latvia and all those countries and go up around the top of the Baltic and come back out. And what was interesting on the return side to the west, we were coming along Sweden, and the Viggens would always try to come up and intercept us. The backseater would say, I got air-to-air interceptor off the right side. I'd look out, and in two occasions, I actually saw a Viggen trying to come up towards us. He was probably in the neighborhood of, I'm going to guess, 40 to 50,000 feet. And to simulate a shot at an SR-71, because he's coming on a side profile, he'd have to get his nose up ahead of us. And I actually visually saw a guy pull his nose up and fall off like that. So he couldn't quite, I don't think he could quite get the shot. And that was probably about 1982. We would fly out of some operational missions where we launched out of Beale. We'd go up, refuel off right off the coast of California after takeoff, and then we would go up and refuel again off of Alaska, off the Aleutians. And then we'd go down the Kamchatka Peninsula, which is Russia, and we would refuel off Japan, and then we'd go through the DMZ in Korea, and we would recover at Okinawa, Japan. And that was a way of swapping out airplanes. The airplane that was going to return to Beale for maintenance, time required maintenance, would fly an operational sortie in the opposite direction sometimes. And that sortie, as I recall, was about 7 hours out of Beale to Okinawa. We also flew out of RAF Mildenhall. We flew some sorties over the FRG, the Federal Republic of Germany, looking further in towards Russia. And we flew up in the Barents to Murmansk, where the sub pens are. One sortie I recall, we were launched, got a call at 10 o'clock in the morning at Beale Air Force Base in the squadron, said go home, go to bed, come back at midnight. And what happened was they had two SR-71s at Mildenhall. One was in maintenance. The other one took off to fly a sortie up in Murmansk, and he blew an engine and came back and landed. The CNO, Chief of Naval Operations, has a pretty big hammer in the Pentagon, and he said he needed coverage. His satellites were down. He hadn't had coverage approaching 12 hours on the subs. He needed to know what's going on in Murmansk. And they told him about the SR-71 aborting. He said, don't you have another one there? They told him it's in maintenance. He said, when will the airplanes be ready? And they said the soonest time would be about 16 hours. And he said, that's not acceptable. He said, don't you have an airplane capable at Beale? And they said, yes, sir. He said, launch it. And they generated a sortie. I flew that sortie. We took off at midnight, refueled right out of Beale. We refueled off of Hudson Bay towards Newfoundland. We crossed the Atlantic and refueled off the west coast of Norway, went up in the Barents, made our take, came out, took a token offload off of Norway again, and we landed in Mildenhall. And they had a dedicated aircraft there. They downloaded the tapes and everything, and he flew right to Washington, D.C. for processing of that information. Just a visual depiction of some of the areas around the world where we operated. A couple of highlights for me, for my career. One of them was in 1974, September of 74. I had a catastrophic engine disintegration. The engine came apart. We were actually on a functional check flight, what they call an FCF. They had done a double engine change, which required a maintenance hop or test flight. The right engine had just been shipped in from Pratt & Whitney along with three other engines that came in. The left engine that they changed was an engine that had been at Okinawa as a spare. Anyhow, part of the functional check flight was to take it out and see how fast it would go, get it up all the way and make sure the inlets were working and everything. And sometimes you'd have an aerodynamic disturbance, or what they called an unstart, where the inlet wasn't sure exactly where the shockwave was inside the nacelle. And as I said, this was an analog computers, an old system. If it didn't know exactly where it was riding inside the nacelle, the cone that sticks out comes back 26 inches. And from the face of the nacelle to where the engine sits is almost 12 feet. So it takes the supersonic air 26 inches back. There's some static ports in a circle, and it rides on those static ports, the supersonic air, and then it breaks it down. It's a bleed bypass engine. Some of the air goes around and is dumped into the afterburner section, and we get more thrust. It's almost a ramjet effect. If it's not sure that the shockwave is in the right place, since it's an analog and not a smart system, the way it corrects it is it'll take that spike that's 26 inches back, it'll drive it all the way forward, which in reality kicks out about 85 to 90% of your thrust. It's like a compressor stall on a normal turbine engine. The airplane will try to turn sideways in the good engine turning into the bad engine. So to correct that, you didn't have enough rudder authority above about 2.6 Mach to control it. So at 2.1 Mach, what they did was what they called cross-tied the inlets. If one unstarts, within a tenth of a second, the other inlet will unstart. And then you have a recovery procedure to go through. When it unstarted on us, kicked everything forward, and then it started to recover, the fire light came on. I looked in my periscope, and we were up at 77,000 feet. There's no water vapor up there, so I'm not having a contrail like you see your commercial airliners. But I could see smoke. And I told the backseater, it was not Ed at this point, I told the backseater, his name was Don, I said, we're on fire. And I started going through the engine fire shutdown checklist, and he's reading things to me also. And we're starting a supersonic descent. The handbook, the flight handbook says that there's extreme yaw, pitch, and roll during the supersonic descent, and that it's possible to flame out an engine. So at some point while we're doing this, Don's a great big guy. He's about 6'4", 6'5", and you'll see a picture of him here in a second. He steadied himself on the in the back seat because he was bouncing around so much. And at that time, the communication panel that he had, they were knobs that you pulled up and turned for volume. And he turned off all his communication without realizing it. He wasn't talking to me. I'm asking for checklists. And about then, my pressure suit starts to inflate, and I realize we're losing cabin pressure, and the left engine generator trips off the line. We're on battery power only. And I'm just going through everything by memory as much as I can, because he's not talking to me, reading me stuff. We only had memory items that, you know, you could act immediately, and then we had to start reading other stuff. I realized that the engine must have been flamed out, and I look at the RPM and the EGT, and I took the throttle, and that TEB that I talked about, every time you came out of idle, or excuse me, cut off to idle, you got a shot of TEB, and whenever you went in afterburner, you got a shot of TEB. The throttle was in idle. I just jammed it into afterburner. I saw the EGT start coming up. I could feel the pressure suit start to deflate. Cabin pressure's coming back up. I reset the generator, and somewhere at that point, Don had realized what he'd done in the back seat, and he turned his intercom back on, and he says, are you still there? I said, what happened? He said, I'll tell you later. He said, what do you need? And I said, right now, a heading. Because I wasn't sure where Okinawa was. He said, west. And I said, okay, when we level off, you're going to have to resync the navigation system. Give me a platform. My ADI had tumbled, my attitude indicator. I was basically flying, looking outside at the horizon and the ocean, and flying on the whiskey compass. I don't think they have whiskey in them anymore. That's World War I and II, maybe. I don't know. But it tilts and turns opposite when you're turning or if you're pitching up and down. So I got as close to west as I could get till I leveled off and had wings level. And by then, Don had synced the heading system, and we were headed pretty close to west. And we made our way back and made a safe landing. There's Don. So we were in a Air Force magazine for a well-done award. The next one was my next tour when I was with Ed McKim. Ed is an experienced navigator. He came out of B-52s. As an aside, Ed flew in the 1972 raids over Hanoi in the B-52. He went from the B-52s to the F-111 as a navigator, and then to the SR-71. So I was fortunate to get such an experienced navigator to fly with. It was his first tour. He was new to the SR-71 program. His training started in January of 1981, and we did our first operational tour together the end of July into August of 1981. There was a site within the DMZ that was on a little island that was technically in North Korea. And we'd been getting a lot of indications that there was a SAM site operational there. And they have the capability with their equipment to actually simulate a radar signal, or they can lock onto you and simulate that they're going to, they're not simulating, they can actually go to what they call high PRF or pulse recurrence frequency, like they're sweeping like this, and then they can zoom, go down and narrow sweep and lock onto you. What they can simulate is that they fired a missile, and they can simulate talking to the missile. And that was one of the biggest things that this airplane had compared to other defensive systems for other aircraft, is we had the capability to know if the missile answered. So anyhow, that's what happened. Ed and I, it had been quiet. We had made a couple passes on our last pass through the DMZ. Ed says, I have a radar lock on. They've gone to high PRF. I don't know if he said simulated, but he said they fired a missile. And he said, they're talking to the missile. And I believe, excuse me, Ed, the next word I heard was, oh shit, the missile answered. So he went through his procedures of turning on the jammer, which is a high power jammer that has about a megawatt of power. I accelerated and turned off track. When we landed back at Okinawa, Japan, no one knew what had happened. They knew we were off track, and the commander asked what happened, told him what happened, and he said, oh my gosh. He said, come quick, let's go into debrief and talk with intelligence. So once we sat down at the table and went over what happened, the DET commander, he had his NCO, who was a non-commissioned officer, his NCO in charge of communications, and he had him looking through the book, what do we do under this incident? And being a smart, good NCO, he pointed at the commander and he said, you have to call the Pentagon. And you have to inform the White House. It's a national incident. Here's a copy that Ed shared with me. I had one from Newsweek that I didn't put on this, but here's the New York Times article about us being shot at. Another highlight was I had met Chuck Yeager when I was stationed in Japan. He was the wing commander at Clark Air Base, and he came up for a safety demonstration or presentation at Yokota Air Base where I was stationed in Japan. We met. Did his presentation and so forth. He had retired as a brigadier general, and in all his flight tests and everything, he'd never gone over Mach 3. He lived in the vicinity of Beale Air Force Base, and he somehow talked to some people he knew, and he was going to get a ride in the B model two-seat trainer, and I was lucky enough to be the guy that got to ride with Chuck Yeager. So that was really neat for me. He's a very interesting, down-to-earth gentleman. A lot of people don't like him because he's clipped in what he says. He's to the point, and he'll say exactly what's on his mind. So anyhow, maybe we're similar. I'm not sure. But we got along fine. When we were up at cruise flying the aircraft, we hand-flew the whole thing. We didn't use any autopilots. We're cruising along at about close to 80,000 feet. We'd done our Mach 3.2, and he's flying the airplane, and he says, Maury, take the plane. And I said, excuse me? And he said, take the plane. I said, everything okay? Because I'm in the back seat. I had enough instrumentation and emergency equipment that I can see that everything looks normal. And I said, what's going on? And he starts like laughing a little bit. And he still has, to that day, still, and I'm sure he still does, has that West Virginia drawl. And he says, golly, he said, you can see forever. And I said, excuse me? And he starts laughing again, and he said, when you're flying flight test, it's like a one-armed paper hanger. You don't have time to look outside. Everything's going on. He said, this is amazing. He said, I can see forever. He really enjoyed that. In closing, the program and the people, it was a fantastic program. Everyone was so dedicated to what they do. The enlisted, the NCOs, the officers. It was a unique, one-of-a-kind program, and everybody sort of stepped it up a notch because they knew that, and they took, not that they don't take pride in what they do with everything else, but it was like a little extra percentage here on the pride. And everyone talked to each other, we all got along, and have made some lifelong friendships. As an example of that, when I had that engine that exploded on me, the Air Force being the Air Force, they had to have an accident investigation team to make sure that I wasn't the cause of the engine exploding. So I didn't go home when I was supposed to go home out of Okinawa because they were convening a team to come over and do the accident investigation. When the team showed up, the chief mechanic for the engine shop, Mike Jerfy is the gentleman's name. He and I have known each other for quite a while. He said he had a presentation he wanted to make before the panel when they convened the panel. And everybody says, what's he want? So he came in. And he told us that that engine came in from Pratt & Whitney a couple days before. No one had a chance to inspect those engines when they decided to stick it in that airplane. And he said, I just can't understand how that engine shelled itself. And he said, I went back and looked at the other, it was two or three engines that came in, and I discovered that the stator blades, the front part of the compressor, these blades that slide in a channel, they have a piece that goes in that's called a keeper. He said there were no keepers in any of those other engines in the stator blades. So obviously, when he had the unstart, the spike kicks out, negative pressure, it sucked those blades out. When it tries to capture it, it sucked them all back in, and it just shelled that engine. So the accident investigation board didn't last very long. Just some nice photos. We have a KC-135 refueling. They had gone on to the KC-10. I got to refuel behind that before I left the program, and it was really sweet to refuel behind that. The 135s were too slow, and they had to pick up speed for us. The sun could still get in and shine in your face if it's an early morning refueling headed east. The KC-10 was so big it blocked the sun. They would go any speed you wanted to go up to 0.9 Mach, which was nice. I'm going to open it up for some questions. Yes, sir. Okay, with regard to the SR-71, what do I miss the most? What do I miss the least? I guess what I miss the most is probably when everything was going well and you're up at cruising altitude, you've got everything trimmed up, the airplane's humming along. It was like a thoroughbred racehorse. It wanted to go higher and faster. You had fuel quantities that you kept track of, and when it was humming, you would get ahead of the fuel curve. I've been up over 2,000 pounds ahead of the fuel curve. I mean, it was a performer. What do I miss the least? The politics involved with the mission. They were always trying to close the program. There were always rumors that cost too much, it's not cost effective, we want to get rid of it. The question is that he was told that the aircraft was able to fly anywhere without worrying about being shot down or anything with regard to the SAMs, and that hundreds of SAMs had been shot at it. That is true. After the incident with Ed and I, and they went back and looked at a lot of the data that they got from flights out of Okinawa at Strategic Air Command headquarters, they discovered that there had been SAM shot at other aircraft, but nobody ever saw them. I saw the one shot at us. When Ed told me that the missile had answered, I looked over the nose and I saw it coming up, and I told him that. Your question is true. The biggest threat after the SA-2 was the SA-5, and the Air Force had a new defensive system called the DEF-H, which was for the SA-5, and I actually flew some tests on the SA-5 system out in that place that everybody says doesn't exist, out in the desert out of Las Vegas. That was interesting. We were on a racetrack pattern going in and out, and they would jam us and so forth, or they would try to lock on, we would jam them and see what the results were. And the backseater was actually Don Bullock, the guy that you saw there. And Don says, boy, from everything they tell us, this looks just like what the thing's supposed to work like. You know, I wonder what the equipment is, where they got it. Jokingly, I said, maybe the Israelis got it for them. You built it? Oh, this gentleman built it. Okay. Well, when I was at Beale on the first tour, we used to fly up the by Vladivostok. They also have subpens up by Vladivostok. And we'd fly some sorties up there, and the Foxbat would come up after us, the MiG-25. And myself and another SR-71 pilot, we were sent to, General Dynamics in, what are they, outside of Dallas, Texas? Fort Worth. We went to Fort Worth to General Dynamics. We were told we were going to be paired up with another pilot. Turned out the other pilot that he had, the other pilot I had, they were both air defense pilots, flew Air Defense Command at the time, interceptors of the F-106. And we got paired up with our guy. We went for a simulator test, they told us. Well, it was not like any simulator I've ever seen. We went in a room, and it was basically computers, wires, and things running everywhere. Excuse me. They had a table set up with a chair for him. They had a table set up with a chair for me. My table with the chair just had some instruments and a stick so that I could try to fly with an attitude indicator. I don't really know what he had on his. But basically, he was trying to shoot me down and simulating what was taking on when we would fly over Vladivostok. What they discovered was the only chance they had, they felt, that was viable, they being the engineers at General Dynamics, was that they would have to be in a racetrack pattern, the Foxbat, and they would have to have it so that when we came over, they were headed just behind us. They had just turned at the end of their circle, and they would have about a 15-second launch window because we would be pulling away from them. They were advertised Mach 3, but they, when the guy defected to Japan and we got a hold of that airplane, it had a very, very limited Mach 3 capability. No, the question was about the incident over Korea with the visual sighting of an SA-2 shot at us, and he wanted to know if that was the only time I ever had to jam the missile. No, there were times we never saw anything, but we had indications. When I got there in 73, we even though the war ended in April of 73 in Vietnam, we overflew Vietnam all the way up to 78 when I left. We were still overflying. And we would get indications of launches and so forth, but no one ever had a visual. The question was the sortie requested at the last minute by the Chief of Naval Operations, what if we had weather in the area? How did we get any information or data? Basically, that was the question, correct? We had, at that time, we had what's called ASAR's Automatic Synthetic Aperture Radar, which was an amazing system in the fact that it was radar, but you could get a product, I could show it to you, and you wouldn't be able to tell if it was took with a radar camera or with a digital camera. It had a lock-on and a spotlight mode. Our previous radar just looked at a point as you went past it. With the ASARs, Ed'll correct me if I'm wrong, with the ASARs you could actually lock onto a point, go down to a 2,000-foot radius, I believe, or circle, 1,000-foot diameter, whatever, 1,000, and concentrate all your energy, and that's where you would get those pictures that I'm saying that would look like almost like a photograph. And it would gimbal as you went past it, so it would stay on the target. Were we required to pre-breathe because of the altitudes we're going to? The U-2s did, because they could take off and climb straight up to altitude. The SR, we could do that, and even when we did the one I mentioned where we had more of a fuel load and went up right away, our suit-up time was a little longer than theirs, or earlier than theirs, if you want to put it that way, and we would close up our faceplate and everything and be breathing 100% oxygen approximately almost anywhere between 25, 35 minutes before we even started engines. So we would be pre-breathing on the way out, so to speak. The question is distance, takeoff and landing, and if you got in trouble, where are you going to find an airport that could accommodate you? When we did our mission planning, first of all, I'm going to do the last first. We had airports that we depicted. If we're here, we're going to go there, depending on where something happened, if we had a problem. With regard to landing, as long as you had a good drag chute, when that aircraft landed, it had a drag chute that was deployed, and that drag chute weighed a little over 200 pounds. It was like throwing an anchor out. The airplane had no high lift devices like that's like slats, flaps, spoilers. So it had no other devices to slow it down or cause drag. So it was just the drag chute and the brakes. And you needed, I want to say, in the neighborhood of, depending on airport altitude, I would say 5,500 to 7,000 feet of runway. Takeoff was in the realm of 4,500 feet. But obviously, you would need something longer if you lost an engine on takeoff and had to stop. So you couldn't just say, oh, they can take off out of a 6,000-foot runway. Well, they may, but, you know, what if something went wrong? Trying to think, did I ever do any diverted landings? Yes, I diverted to MacDill Air Force Base on a Cuban sortie. On the Cuban sortie, we would drop down over Louisiana and refuel in the Gulf of Mexico before we ran our take, because sometimes we'd make two passes. So climbing, just leveled off at cruise to go start the take to go into Cuba, and we had a double generator failure. And we turned towards MacDill. One of the generators reset, but the show was over, so we diverted into MacDill. They had special code words that all military facilities were familiar with. I don't know if any civilian facilities had it, but for going into a military field, we would make an emergency call, tell them we're a tactical aircraft, senior crown. Senior crown was the code word. They had a book in their command post. They'd look in there. It'd tell them what we were and what we needed. Refuelings were anywhere from 15 to 20 minutes. Yeah. We actually refueled twice. We refueled right after takeoff, and we refueled off of, I'm trying to remember if we refueled off of Newfoundland or someplace like that. That's correct. Actually, a little background. In, I believe it was 1958, after the U-2s had been flying, Lockheed went to the Air Force and said they felt the airplane was vulnerable, the U-2, that the Russians were improving their missiles. They were going to be able to shoot it down. And they came up with a proposal for the A-12, what was going to be the A-12. And so there were a bunch of meetings and discussions and stuff that carried on for a year, maybe longer, when they finally got the go-ahead to start some sort of prototype design and production, etc. So the SR-71 actually started in sometime in 58 on paper, or at least on proposed inventory, if you want to say, of what they were going to do. The question was, has any foreign or even an entity within the United States possibly come up with some sort of follow-on? To my knowledge, no, as technology, money, and politics go, I would say they've looked at, you know, that Wave Rider that they're working on, which is going to be a hypersonic Mach 5 plus. That's something they're working on, a ramjet. But as far as what the SR-71 actually did, no, there hasn't been, to my knowledge. The most memorable flight Ed and I had? Yeah, other than the one you saw on the video. Well, now this might not be memorable for Ed, but we used to fly in the T-38 in the companion trainer. I'll buy you lunch after I tell this. And just to get flight time, because you could, once you were checked out in the SR-71, you didn't fly it like you do other aircraft all the time, and it was cheap to operate the T-38 trainer, so we'd go up and fly around in that. And they decided to start letting the RSOs get two or three flights a month if they were at Beale in the T-38. We went out on a cross country from Beale to, where'd we go? Davis-Monthan in Tucson. And I used to let Ed fly a little bit. But Ed has progressed since then. He still flies. But I let him fly the T-38 once in a while. We came in the traffic pattern, and Ed's in the back seat, obviously, so I don't know what he's doing. I don't know how he flies with regard to, I'm not looking at him. We came in the traffic pattern, went around the traffic pattern, and then I told Ed, you can have a turn, and we'll make a low approach. So we, as we come turn into the traffic pattern, I notice I get a red flag on my ADI that says the system's tumbled. It's not reliable. And I'm looking outside, and Ed rolls out, and then his ADI is canted because it's not reliable. The red, I don't know if he didn't get a red flag or he just didn't see it. Anyhow, he's trying to level that, and we're about like this coming down the initial approach. And I said, Ed, he says, what? I said, look outside. I apologize, Ed. Ed said, oh, shit. What? Nothing like the truth. He wanted to know if we have a buffet onset chart for the SR-71 with regard to stall. Could be high-speed stall or slow-speed stall. No. The SR-71, that was one of the drawbacks. It's a double delta planform. There's no traditional wing rock or buffet. What happens when the airplane stalls, it snaps up, breaks in half, right behind the RSO. They actually lost an aircraft over the Philippines. Do you know what year that was? Was that 87 or 89? 89. I had just retired from the Air Force and had gone back to United Airlines in 87. And I remember they had to convene before the three-star general at March Air Force Base, the 15th Air Force commander. And the guy that was going to give the presentation, I was still living in the area, he asked me to come watch his briefing. He said, you still have clearances? And I said, I don't know, I've been out almost a year, I said, but or over a year, I said, but when I debriefed, they told me I couldn't do anything for 3 years or talk about anything for 3 years. I said, so I, in some form, maybe I still have clearances. And I said, and your classified briefing isn't that classified to begin with. He said, okay, well, I don't want to piss off the three-star general. Run through this with me and make sure it's okay. What happened, they had something very similar to what I had, only in this case, when the engine disintegrated, and I don't know the cause of that one, all the parts blew into the fuselage. So it severed all the hydraulic and oil lines, and he was losing his flight controls. And they were slowing down. They knew they were going to have to punch out. They weren't sure when it was going to stall out, but they bailed out in the Mach 2 range. I'm not sure just how fast, Mach 2. And they were getting as close to the Philippines as they could. Some indigenous fishermen saw the airplane come down. They went out in their fishing boats and they picked these two guys up. They were in the water. They took them back ashore. The Air Force knew what was going on by now. They were launching someone to go to the area, a Navy ship. And the Russians happened to have a ship in the area that supposedly was headed towards the crash site also. I believe it had, did it have the Def H on it? It did. It had the Def H, which was the latest version at that time of the jamming equipment. And they started a search. The Air Force did. The Russians were probably looking for it. No one could find the wreckage. And out of circumstance, or happenstance, I guess, somebody asked one of the people that rescued the crew, they said, did you see that plane go down? And the guy says, they spoke English, and they said, yeah, I know exactly where it is. And they just looked at him and he says, what do you mean you know exactly where it is? He said, I stuck three sticks in the ground to pinpoint the position, and he took them over where the sticks were. He said, triangulate off this, it's about 2 miles out in the water. And they found it. True story. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Seniors Out and About here at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance. I'm Betty Wheaton. I'll see you next time.